Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us at the Bartlett School of Sustainable Construction. My name is Chizuba, and we are here with Dr. Yiming Wang to talk to you about our MSc in Infrastructure, Investment and Finance. So Dr. Wang will give you a brief overview of the course, and then it will be over to you to ask as many questions as you want. If you would like to ask questions, please drop them in our Q&A function at the bottom of the screen. That way we won't lose anyone's questions and we can answer them in order. Also, if you'd like to talk directly, you can ask to be unmuted and you can talk to Dr. Wang yourself. That's also very welcome. So without any further ado, I will hand over to Dr. Wang.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Yiming Wang. I'm currently the program lead for the MSc in Infrastructure, Investment and Finance course. So I don't know whether I should say good afternoon or good morning or good evening, because I'm conscious that there are quite a few participants in this event, and some of you might be coming from a different time zone. So without further ado, I would like to use some slides just to briefly introduce the program. So I'm basically going to cover 4 points. I'm going to give you a brief introduction about the history and the current status of IIF. Then I'm going to spend some time regarding the structure of the teaching and the program. Certainly, I will also talk about the current management team of the IIF program. So by the way, this is subject to change next year. So this is basically the up-to-date information, but might change next year. I'm telling you the management team information basically in case any of you would like to keep in touch and ask any questions by email, then you know whom you should contact. And finally, I would like to leave some time for questions and answers, of course. So very briefly about IIF, it is one of the elite programs housed within the School of Sustainable Construction, within the Bartlett Faculty of Built Environment at UCL. So the program actually has a relatively long history. So it was launched in 2013, so it's 9 years ago. Originally as a collaboration between University College London and the European Investment Bank. So until now, this collaboration still exists, and even notwithstanding the Brexit, so the European Investment Bank has still been working very closely with us. Every year we have experts from EIB visiting us and giving guest lectures on some of the modules. And likewise, the program is officially accredited by the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors. So this RICS accreditation is recognized globally, and certainly RICS is based in London. In terms of the purpose of the program, I think I should emphasize that from the very beginning, from the very early stage of the program, as I said, launched in 2013. It was designed for the purpose of training and giving further training to early and mid-career professionals. So in that sense, the program has a strong emphasis on professional training. So it's not a standard academically oriented MSc program. It has a strong emphasis on professional experience. Likewise, the program has a strong focus on the commercial sector. So basically the private sector involvement in the infrastructure world. So as we know, infrastructure business very much takes place in the interplay between the private and public sector. There are a lot of infrastructure projects and programs involving procurement by the public sector. But the focus of this program is very much on the commercial realm, and also with a global perspective. We have a very diversified, both culturally and in terms of language, in terms of ethnicity, student body. And we also aim to train our students to become the future infrastructure professionals all over the world. So we have an embedded global perspective. So if you are fortunate enough to join us next year, you'll be able to see it yourself. You'll see our students coming from different parts of the world. And their focus on the infrastructure business also is featured with an international focus. So I think many of you would be interested to know more about the structure of the program. So we are actually in a kind of transition year this time, because there are some modifications in terms of program structure. But for next year, so we are moving to this new structure in terms of having five compulsory modules. So as you can see on the slide, so we have five compulsory or mandatory modules. So you don't have to choose, you just need to take them. So they are infrastructure finance, infrastructure economics, global environmental issues in infrastructure investment. That's very much focused upon green infrastructure, green finance, et cetera. Then demand forecasts, risk modeling, and appraisal methods. That's a more finance-related module. And finally, infrastructure as an asset class. So we have five modules as mandatory modules for you to take. So for a typical full-time student, because we have students from choosing different routes. So we have full-time students, we have part-time students, and we have students who are going to take the flexible route. But for a typical full-time student, you are going to be taking four of the compulsory modules, four of the five compulsory modules in the first term, right? And in the second term, you are going to take one more compulsory module plus three out of the six optional modules. So if you look at the list of the optional modules, you can see there are six of them. So in the second term, so usually the spring term, you just need to select three out of six, yeah? Then plus one mandatory module. So we are basically talking about four compulsory modules in the autumn, one compulsory module plus three optional modules in the spring. And finally, in the summer, you need to get registered for this school's dissertation module. So it's also a module, but essentially you're supposed to submit a dissertation, which would be managed school-wide by the Bartlett School of Construction and Project Management. So this is the basic program structure for next year. If you go online, see the program information, you probably will see some different information. That's because of some legacy information is still there and subject to change. But as far as I can see, for next year, we are going to have five compulsory modules plus three optional modules. So in total, eight modules plus one dissertation. Yeah, I hope this makes sense. And certainly we are going to be able to talk about the program structure during the Q&A session. Now let me move to program management for the current year. So I'm currently the program leader or program director. So I'm in charge of the overall management of the IRF program. In the meantime, we also have a deputy leader who is Dr. Giuliano Denico. So Dr. Denico, he will be mainly in charge of admission. So when you submit your applications, both I and Giuliano will be reviewing them, but he will probably spend more time on the admission side. And likewise, if you have any procedural issues, you can approach the admission team, but I also would like to know that we have two program administrators currently. One is Robin, the other is Maria. So they are mainly in charge of the day-to-day running of the program and logistical issues. So not exclusively for admission, but if you have any related questions, so you can certainly approach us. And I think that's my very, very brief introduction about the IIF program, because I think in the audience, probably you have viewed most of the information online, and I want to set aside more time for Q&A. I'll hand over to Chizuba.
Okay, thank you so much for that. To everyone who has joined us during the brief overview, if you have any questions, please do let us know. In case you missed what I said at the beginning, you can either type in your questions in the Q&A function at the bottom of the page, and I will go through that and we'll answer it. Or if you want to talk to us directly and unmute yourself, please do let us know. And that is also absolutely fine. Dr. Wang, we have one question for you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jeff. It says, is financial modeling a required skill for this program? My background is in public administration, and there's a little focus on finance.
Yeah, so thank you, Jeff, for the question. So I think that's certainly a valid question. And we have students from a diversity of background, actually, during the past few years. I think it's not a prerequisite for you to have prior training in terms of financial modeling, but certainly because by the name of our program, IIF, right, Infrastructure Investment and Finance, we are going to give you training in terms of financial modeling, risk management, analysis, etc. So I think while it would not be a prerequisite, it would be good for you to get some exposure to financial modeling, because we are going to cover it anyway. But otherwise, don't worry, because as I said, we have quite a few students in the past coming from public management, public administration, public policy background. And in my own case, my PhD is actually in public policy, although my research is very much focused on public finance. My short answer is no, it's not a prerequisite, but you'll receive corresponding training if you join our program.
Thank you. Our next question is anonymous, and the question is, how are exams conducted? And Dr. Wang, if I could expand on that, and if you could talk about other forms of tests or dissertations as well, not just the exams.
Yeah. So I think if you mean assessment, right? So if we expand it a little bit, exam is just one mode of assessment. So we do have some modules which rely on exams. So if you are specifically talking about exams, so these are usually conducted nowadays because COVID is over. So in a physical setting, in a room near UCL. So that would be administered, usually 2-hour exams, asking you to answer questions. Some are multiple choice, some are more like written down answers. But otherwise, we have also other forms of assessment. For instance, many modules involve assessment by asking you to write an essay. Yeah. Also, other modules might have assessment asking you to do a project or project portfolio. That's what I've seen. I've also been in charge of a module, so asking students to work as a group, to do group work as if you're going to do in the real world setting for infrastructure development company. So you're going to work on a project as a team and then do the financial analysis and present the results to the board of executives, for example. So I would say there are different types and modes of assessment. And let alone that we also have something called formative assessment, if you haven't heard of that. So summative assessment is basically assessment which are going to be marked and counted toward your final degree. Well, in order for us to give you the opportunity to do summative assessment well, be it an exam or group presentation or portfolio or project simulation, We are going to give you training through formative assessment. For example, we will ask you to present your essay before it's due, but your presentation will not be formally marked, although we are going to give you feedback. So that is what usually happened in terms of teaching on IIF. I hope I answered that question.
I think you did. But as always, if anybody wants to put a follow-up question in the queue, please feel free. This is your time. This is what the session is for. No question is too big or too small. So if you want a follow-up question, do add it to the queue. Our next question asks, do we need to show specific or academic engineering or math knowledge when applying for this program? My background is in accounting and finance.
Yeah, so I would say, again, this is something, you know, if it's one of your strengths, you can certainly try to demonstrate it in your application. So your personal statement, for example, or your references, for example, but it's not if you don't have that kind of component, I would say it's not a deal breaker. But although we do have a kind of mass refresher session every year at the beginning of the term, partly because the program does have an expectation, does have an element in terms of financial modeling. So I think if you're coming from an accounting finance background, actually that's a quite good fit between your background and the program's overall expectation. Although for students who are not from accounting finance background, I'd say that's not a 100% required. So I think my answer is no. Although if you're from accounting finance background, it's a plus.
And our next question is, in the degree, is there an internship component? If there is none, are we allowed to engage in part-time work while taking the program?
Yes, so that's a very good question. So there's no official internship element included in the program, because as you can see, it's a one-year program with 9 months of teaching. It's actually already very intensive. But if you do prefer to do part-time work whilst attending the course, you can. So we do have a part-time route. So for full-time students, basically each student is expected to graduate within 1 year of time. But for part-time students, you will get another year. So the program structure, as I just mentioned during my presentation, would look slightly different because you will be spending 2 years on the program. But certainly if you want to do part-time work, you can.
The next question says, I have been working for 10 years now in the field of PPPs. Do I need an academic recommendation?
Right. So I think if you have already had a lot of experience in the industry, I think it makes sense for you to at least have a recommendation from the industry by professional experts. I think it makes perfect sense. Although I think you, if you can get an academic reference, that would show a better balance, because after all, IIF is a MSc program. So if you can show a balance between recognition in the industry as well as in academia, I think that would be a plus. Although. If somehow you find it difficult to obtain reference from academia, then I think given the IIF's focus on the commercial aspect of infrastructure business, I think it wouldn't be a problem if you only use industry, reference from the industry.
Our next question comes in three parts, so I'll break it up. It starts with, thank you very much for arranging this session. You're very welcome. Number one question, how many students are accepted per year? Number two, for those not coming from a finance background, could you recommend background materials? And And could you tell us more about requirements for the dissertation? Just before you start, Dr. Wang, I just want to say that I will put in the chat function the link to the UCL prospectus page, yeah, which will break down especially number 3 question, yeah, in more detail, and you can use that as a reference point as you go through your application process. So just in case you don't have that to hand, I will add that in, but I will hand over to Dr. Wang to answer the other ones. So just to remind you again, Dr. Wang, the first one was how many students roughly are accepted per year?
Yeah, yeah. So clearly we don't actually operate based on a kind of quota system. So we are looking at students case by case basis. So for instance, this year we have admitted roughly 40 students, and because we also have students from previous year who are taking the course on a part-time basis. So we have about 40 students currently on the course. But that's roughly the number we are looking at. So we are making decisions not based on any quota, but based on whether the students are fit for the program. So I would encourage you to look at the admission criteria. And so my answer to the second question is certainly related. So this is a infrastructure investment and finance program. So certainly if you are coming from a finance background, that would fit. However, this is not a purely finance program. So if you have a related experience, for example, or if you have an academic background related to civil engineering, related to public finance, and I think you can still apply for IRF, and you just need to emphasize where you come from when you decided to apply for. I think my video was off. Can you see me now?
Yeah, you just had a little bandwidth problem for a minute.
Okay.
Well, you're back. Well, we could hear you.
Okay, that's good. So as I've just mentioned, if you're coming from a background not directly related to finance, that's okay, because we have a focus on infrastructure. So you just need to emphasize the relevance of your academic or professional backgrounds to the program. And in terms of recommended background materials, I think if you are not from a finance background, I would recommend that you take any textbook, for example, on cooperative finance. Yeah, so the basic concepts. For example, return to equity, right? Asset equity ratio. So these basic concepts will get you onto the ladder of cooperative finance. Because a lot of the materials taught on the program is essentially in the realm of cooperative finance. And what's the third question? I think that's about the dissertation, right, Shizuba? If I'm correct.
Yes.
So what's the best place for you to acquire the related information in terms of dissertation is actually from the prospectus, which is available online. But basically the dissertation will be managed school-wide. So we will have a dedicated team school-wide to manage the process. So because we also have other MSc programs, so all the students will go through roughly similar process, but certainly with different topic. For RF students, the dissertations will certainly be focused on any topics directly related to infrastructure. But there will be a series of workshops teaching everyone the basics, for example, you know, how to identify a topic, how do you know whether it's research worthy, and to something rather detailed, like referencing, formatting, you know, how to write up an acknowledgement at the end of process. So that will be managed school-wide. And hopefully you can find more detailed information online in the prospectus.
And I have put the link to the prospectus in the chat function. Our next question was more like a comment, and I'm not sure if it was a comment in relation to a previous question. So they've written about the minimum what is needed for admission. So the person wrote, "I've observed that the minimum requirement for admission is an upper second class bachelor's degree from a UK university in a relevant subject, including engineering, mathematical based science, built environment, economics, and finance, or an overseas qualification of an equivalent standard. In exceptional cases, a lesser academic qualification combined with substantial professional experience and demonstrable academic ability will allow acceptance onto the program." So I'm not sure if that was in relation to a previous thing we're talking about, but just to link that to a question, three questions below, somebody says, if you do not have a 2-1, what level of experience is sufficient to be considered to the program? So I'll just put those two together.
So I think because what I see in the chat box, it's not really a
It's not a question,
question,
no,
right?
but I wanted to link it to a question that we have, which says, what level of experience is sufficient if you don't have a 2-1?
So as I said, so we do have admission criteria, and but our decisions are very much made on a case-by-case basis, especially because IIF has a strategic focus on early to mid-career professionals. So a lot of professionals might have left the universities for quite a while, but they have a lot of experience industry. So if, as mentioned in the admission criteria, if the case it is genuinely exceptional, and we will take that into consideration. So what I would like to emphasize is if you feel you have a strong non-academic proficiency or strength, I would urge you to demonstrate it in your application. So in your personal statement, for example, and in your references. So that would make us aware of the strengths you have apart from the academic achievement. But in short, as I said, our admission decisions are made on a case-by-case basis. So it's up to you to demonstrate your strengths, and we will take that into consideration.
Our next question says, could you share information on in-house scholarship opportunities for this program? So I'll take that one if you don't mind, Dr. Wang. So UCL generally has a wide range of scholarships, but for the Bartlett itself, the Faculty of the Built Environment, we have the Bartlett scholarship, the Bartlett Promise, which is the Bartlett scholarship program that covers a wide range of opportunities for both undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD students. So it's quite a lot of information, but it's very clear and concise, and they have a personal team that's on hand to answer all your questions. So I have put the link for the Bartlett Promise in the chat function. So please do copy the link, save it, and have a look at it when you have the chance. So thank you very much for your question. The next question is from Alexandra. And the question is, what financial modeling skills are taught, learnt in the course? For example, are you taught how to build a model for project finance, or are we exposed to different components that make up a financial model, such as cash flows, taxes, or shareholder loans?
So my short answer, Alexandra, is both. Is both. So it depends on the context of application of these financial modeling skills. So I think that's the right way to teach infrastructure finance. So we teach these skills in the context. So something from very simple basic modeling, such as net present value, weighted average cost of equity. So these are very basic models to something more complex, involving probability, involving uncertainty. So actually we teach both on the program, but as I said, we teach these skills in some specific applied context. It's not like we are a standard financial engineering program. We just teach you how to do these modelings. So that's not the purpose of our program. We are trying to train professionals who are going to be able to understand and apply these financial modeling skills in their routine work. I hope that answers your question.
Our next question is from Faizan. Thank you, Faizan. The question is, may I know if the program has any interactive sessions with the actual industry members, as in courses taken by practitioners or, for that matter, networking events with industry members?
Yes, so that's a very important element of IIF. So as far as I know, in all of the modules, we have actually invited quite a few industry experts to give guest lecture. But in the meantime, teaching staff are also going to give lectures mainly on more theoretical and conceptual stuff. Then we're going to invite professionals to come into the classroom, share their experience. And usually these guest lectures also pose as networking events, opportunities for students, you know, to get to know the professionals. In terms of specifically networking events, I think the school does organize them, but not always exclusively for IIF. But usually we have public events, public lectures, and other networking opportunities with the industry. But I tend not to think that's exclusively for IIF, because as you see, IIF is an elite but small program. Usually every year we have like less than 40 students. So this year the number is slightly large. But consider the size of the program, usually these networking events tend to be organized at a school level rather than the program level.
Thank you. I've got a question from Samuel, which I can answer. He says, is it possible to share the presentation? Hi, Samuel. Yes, this presentation is currently being recorded and will be saved and uploaded to the UCL postgraduate page. And also everybody who registered for this open day session will get the recording sent to them. So yes, you will have a version of this coming to you very soon. It takes the team about a week to upload everything. As you can imagine, we're having graduate sessions across the whole faculty this week. Just give us a little bit of time and it will be uploaded. Thank you very much. The next question says, is there an interview in the admission process of this program?
Yes, there will be an element of interview. Although, as I said, the decision is very much made on a case-by-case basis. But yes, if we feel that there's a need for us to interview you, we will be organizing an interview.
Okay, next question says, where can we see descriptions of the optional courses? I couldn't find the direct links in the UCL website.
Chiluba, could you provide them a link?
Yes, so what I will drop some, I'll double check the prospectus to see if that breaks down the optional courses descriptions, mm-hmm, or if it's just an overview. Mm-hmm. And I'll double check our own website as well. I don't know if our optional courses have descriptions. I think they just have the titles. But while we're on live, I will check for you. And if I find it, I'll put that in the chat function.
Yeah.
Okay, our next question says, if I get selected in the program but fail to secure a scholarship, am I allowed to defer taking my slot until I get a scholarship?
Well, that's a good question, but I'm afraid depends on a number of circumstances. So again, as I said, our decisions are very much made on a case-by-case basis. For us to defer your slot until next year, it depends on a number of factors. For example, how many places we have for the next year. So if we somehow are running over the slots for next year, then obviously that might not be possible to defer. So I think it depends on a number of factors. But generally speaking, as the program lead, I tend not to encourage deferral because you know, it can be 1 year deferral, 2 year deferral, and I don't think it makes sense to constantly deferring an admission decision. So I would usually prefer the student to reapply because every year the situation might change slightly. But if we are talking about a delay due to scholarship, then I think you need to give us a convincing reason for us to consider deferral. But generally speaking, I don't think deferral is a generic decision we would easily take in our case.
And just to add to that, we know that the graduate application process is a long one and can have many twists and turns. We have a fantastic admissions team who are on hand to answer all your questions in regard to your application process and what to do with any bumps along the road in that process. I have put the link to the admissions page in the chat function, so please do go through it, and at the bottom there is an email for further questions, and our admissions team will be very happy to help you with any of your questions about deferring. Our next question, hold on 1 second, says, to what extent does experience argument for a lower grade? The experience in this regard is a corporate lawyer in infrastructure financing in sub-Saharan Africa.
I don't think this is, this is a question I can easily answer without seeing the actual case. So I think, as I said, it depends on a number of factors, but mainly in terms of whether you can demonstrate your professional experience in your application. I've known some cases in which the applicants are actually very strong, very fit, but then in the application, the strength and fitness are not sufficiently demonstrated. So you need to remember that our decisions made based on your application without you telling me why we should admit you, we should accept you, give you a place, and then we simply cannot assume anything. So I'm afraid that question is hard to answer at the moment until I see your application.
The next question says, what kind of employers have shown the most interest in graduates of this course?
Yeah, so certainly we're talking about the demand side, yeah, in the labor market. So when you graduate from IRF, you will be on the supply side. So given the current economic climate, I think it's hard to say, but usually graduates from IRF are highly demanded, partly because a lot of them have already had work experience. So I think in terms of private sector, we have, for instance, I've invited a guest speaker from Mace Group, which is a major construction firm. And we also have someone from Webel Group, which is based in the Netherlands. So we have a variety of employers in this industry which are interested in our graduates. And certainly because we have students, we tend to have students who have already had a lot of experience. So there's no wonder network, and you can get relatively quick insider's view in terms of job markets, even from your peer students.
Our next question is a two-parter. The first one we can't generally answer. The first one says, how many countries have students come from in the 2022 intake and ordinary years? I can answer that. Our students come from all over the world. I do believe we did a survey and realized that mostly every continent was represented, including UK students. And that is the case with all across UCL, just by the very nature of the university that it is, and that is reflected in the Bartlett and in the course itself. A lot of our students in our MSc come from our undergraduate courses, and other comes from other undergraduate courses across the university and have stayed on for MSc. And a lot of our students come from different universities and have come to UCL for their postgraduate part of their career. The second question to Dr. Wang is there a chance to calculate future cash flow and build a mock financial model, including IRR, to judge its proper investment or not? That's what I'm keen.
That's a very theoretical question. As I said, we tend to teach financial modeling in specific contexts, but just by looking at your question, I would argue not from my own perspective, because as we know, any financial modeling involves two basic considerations. One is regarding the return, the other is regarding the risk. So in your case, when you mention IRR, I think you're mainly focused on the return from cash flow or other investment. But I think a good financial model would also need to take into account the risk factor. So you can have a mock model which shows very high return, but then if you don't access a degree of risk, I don't think it can be that useful to judge the potential success or failure of any infrastructure project.
Our next question, which I can take this one, Dr. Wang, is from Benjamin. Thank you, Benjamin. Benjamin says, kindly share more information on whether this program could be delivered online for some of us who might not be able to attend in person. UCL's policy is all our degrees are in person, Benjamin. So we hope that there would be a time in the future when you might be able to join us in London. We do have some distance learning courses, but that doesn't include our master's, our MSc programs, which would have to be in person. And our last question for now says, what have been some usual concerns, issues, or challenges of past IIF students?
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's an interesting question. So I can only answer a question based on my experience. So according to my experience, there are basically two elements. One is about the intensity of the program, because for a typical full-time student, this is a 1 year only program, and you can see there are 8 modules plus dissertation. So it is quite intensive. So some students do feel a bit worn out, pressured, but as I've always told them, you are joining a elite MSc program at UCL, not because it's easy, exactly because it's challenging and it's beneficial for your career and for your future. So I think most students get that. And when they leave the program, they feel satisfied. And another issue we've had, and I think which will be very quickly resolved next year, is our teaching room, because currently we are still very much based in the UCL Bloomsbury campus. But some of you probably know that we also have a East London campus right now near Stratford, Victoria Park. So next year, RF is likely to move to the East London campus. So this rooming capacity issues will be addressed to a certain extent, because everything is new in East London, and the teaching room conditions will be way much better. Was all the broad questions?
And now those are all of our 21 questions. Okay. I think we set a record. which I'm thrilled with because it shows people who are genuinely interested and want to find out more about the MSc. Mm-hmm. We have a few minutes left on the clock. I think we've got about 5 minutes. So if you do have any other questions that you want to write down, let me know. I did see a member of the audience raise their hand a couple of times, but they dropped it back down. So I'm not sure if they wanted to speak or if you just want to type your question. You definitely can. We've got 5 minutes, but while we're waiting, Dr. Wang, a question that does come up is applicants want to know what you're looking for in a personal statement. What will make them stand out in their personal statement as part of their application process for this course?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So I think, as always, when you apply for a kind of elite program such as MSCRF, you would expect the admission process to be competitive. So you want to convince us you are the right person we are going to admit, right? So you might have a very strong academic record, but you also need to show us the relevance of your academic achievement considering IIF, right? Because only telling us that you are academically strong is not enough for us to feel that you are the right person we want to recruit. And likewise, for applicants who have more strengths in terms of the industrial experience, again, you need to demonstrate your strengths. Yeah. So basically my punchline is your personal statement is your opportunity to demonstrate yourself fully, and especially show your strengths, yeah, because that's what matters most. And then if you can try to tell us why RF is the right program for you, why you are enthusiastic about it, why do you feel you are the right person to join the program, and the program can benefit you in terms of the future. And I think these are the key elements we are looking for. But according to my experience, every application is different. Everyone is different. So one thing I think you probably don't want to do is to grab a template from any websites and just fill in the box. I mean, but we can see that. And I've seen some applications in the past. That doesn't make sense, right? Because this is a personal statement. It's supposed to be personal and show you as a real person. And if you can do that, and if you can convince us that you are the right applicant, then I think you would be successful.
And we've got some questions here. What is the success rate in terms of graduating on time of accepted applicants? What have been the issues of those who failed to graduate?
Mm-hmm. I don't have any specific figure, I'm afraid, because you see, every year is different. And during the past 2 years, by the way, I wasn't leading the program during the last few years. So I might need to ask my colleagues, my predecessors, in terms of relevant information. But I can imagine that COVID has had an impact on the progress of some students. But I think in terms of your question, can I return to that question?
Sorry, I've already ticked off the list.
So what have been the issues of those failed to graduate?
Yeah, what problems have our students had generally, which you've touched upon already with regards to stress and managing their time?
Yeah, I think that's the number one reason, time management. I think that's something more widespread. It's not only about IF students. I think for many students on these 1 year programs, I think time management is the key challenge. So I've always trying to tell my students that, for instance, for your dissertation, don't think of it as a kind of a perfect masterpiece. Instead, of think of it as a project which you can manage, which you can finish with sufficient quality. within a constrained period of time. Usually we're talking about several months. So make it manageable. Don't be too ambitious. Because if you are too ambitious, then it's likely that you are going to run over time. So I think that's the number one reason I have witnessed, but certainly there are many other reasons.
There's a question I can answer here that says, is it possible to appeal non-acceptance to the program? So again, for all rules regarding the application process, I will have to direct you to the link which I've put in our chat function. So please do have a look at it. And as always, the admissions team will be able to help you with all the bumps, loopholes, legalities of applying for a course at UCL. The next question is, do modules on the course include courses on valuation?
Depends on what kind of valuation, right? So if you're talking about standard appraisal, again, we're talking about infrastructure assets as a kind of different types of asset. Yeah. So I think your question is slightly abstract, but certainly we do have that element. How to value an asset. Yeah. In terms of its future cash returns or other elements. But it varies. Right? If you're talking about an infrastructure asset which involves very substantial initial investment, fixed capital cost, then that's something substantially different from a regular asset in the stock market, for example. So we can certainly talk more about these detailed subject matters later on if you join the course.
And I'll have to take one last question because of time. It's from Faizan that said, what is the usual acceptance offer rate for the application of this program?
Yeah, so as I said, we don't actually operate on a quota system. So I'm afraid I don't have that specific figure. So when we make our admission decisions, we are more kind of looking at the match, really, whether the application is matching the criteria we set for the program. So I'm afraid I don't have a specific figure, I'm afraid I cannot provide that figure at this stage.
I think what would be really good to highlight is that 1 hour has gone by so quickly and we have to go, but we do have a dedicated inbox for any questions you might have, not just in the application process of this course, but in the application process of any other postgraduate courses that you might be looking at in the Bartlett. Your email is guaranteed to be answered and they will cover any topics you might have. And that's a dedicated team that is up to date with both the application process for the course, the admission process for university, living arrangements, travel, visa, all of it. Because as we said before, we know that it is a big deal applying for a postgraduate degree course. So I have put the dedicated email in the chat box. Please do make a note of it and hold on to it. And like I said, if you do have any further questions, they will be able to answer it for you. I just want to thank Dr. Wang for his time this afternoon. And I want to say a really big thank you to every single person who was here today and asked us such interesting questions. We really do appreciate your time and we appreciate you spending this hour with us. And as I've said, this is recorded and will be available for on-demand viewing. So we're going to wrap it up here, but thank you very much, Dr. Wang. Any final message you want to say before we go? Dr. Wang?
Just want to thank everyone for joining me in this event. And I look forward to receiving your applications.
Okay, thank you, everybody, and have a good rest of your day.
Bye.